Okay, in this question, and continue on with exercise 2A of the book Fundamental Applied Mathematics. We're on page number 42, and the question is the final question, number 11. This is from the Leaving Certificate Ordinary Level 1984. Well, that was just before I was born, so that's a long time ago, I suppose you could say. Okay, so we'll start with, it says define velocity and speed. Well, that's a good question. That's something I've been trying to, trying to give people a sense of. So, okay, let's define speed. Speed. Well, let's help with our formula. Distance, speed, time in our little triangle like this. That gives me distance is equal to speed divided by time. Speed is equal to distance over time. And time is equal to distance over speed. So, how do you read this? You could literally say speed is equal to distance divided by time, and that's a good definition, I would think. However, there is a much better distance, or a much better explanation, and I'll give it to you now. We know that speed is equal to distance divided by time. So let's put that into English, and you will say speed is the rate of change of distance with respect to time. Does that make any sense? Well, it does. The rate of change of distance. So, say if we had a distance of 20 meters, he starts at distance 20 and finishes at a distance of 100 meters. When we plug this into UVast, we would always say the distance travelled was equal to 80 meters. Or something like that. You'd say the total distance covered. So it's the change of distance. And that's nothing new. So that's what we're doing, even if we didn't know that's what we're doing. And is it with respect to time? Of course it's respect to time. It's not respect to anything else. And that should be reasonably obvious to you. So yes, you could say speed is equal to distance over time. That's the formula. Or you could say speed is the rate of change of distance with respect to time. I think that if you think about that, it should make reasonable sense. Now, the next question is define velocity. Now, if we remember back to our chapter on vectors, a vector has both magnitude and it's got direction. And the magnitude is the number associated with it. So speed is the magnitude for velocity. And direction, if you have a direction and a speed, that gives you a velocity. So, let's just give a quick example of that. A quick example would be 10 meters per second. That's a speed, because it only has a magnitude or a number. However, if you said 10 meters per second north, that's a velocity. Okay? So how do we alter our definition of speed in order to encompass velocity? I would say this. Velocity is the rate of change of distance with respect to time in a given direction. And that encompasses the fact that it has both magnitude and direction. So that's the first part there. If that didn't make sense to you, once again, place a comment underneath the video. I'm just trying to give you a sense of these things. If you actually think about what's being said, just for a moment, sit back and think about it, then it should make sense. So we're given, show the speed of 1 kilometer an hour is equivalent to 5 over 18 meters per second. So we're given 1 km per hour HR like that. So first of all, how many meters are in a kilometer? 1,000 meters is equal to 1 kilometer. And we know that there are 3,600 seconds in an hour. Because there are 60 seconds in a minute, 60 minutes in an hour, 60 times 60 gives you 3,600. Look at question number 10, where I've done that slightly. I've done that a lot slower, in fact. So if that doesn't make sense, look at question 10. So how do we convert 1 kilometer an hour to meters per second? The first thing you do is you leave the magnitude unchanged. You multiply that magnitude by the number of meters in a kilometer. And you leave this unit here the same. So we'll say there's 1 times 1,000 meters per hour. So that's 1,000.
Fuck! Why does it keep fucking happening?
So we have 1,000 meters per hour. Next, do the exact same thing, but this time for the time. So it's 1,000 meters times the number of seconds in an hour. We actually don't do the same thing. Sorry, I was after confusing myself. We know that there are 1,000 meters traveled in 1 hour. But we also know that there are 3,600 seconds in 1 hour. So therefore, in order to get the number of meters traveled per second, we need to divide the distance by the time. And that'll give you per second. So that is 1,000 divided by 3,600. And that gives me 5/18 meters per second. That's in, or you could say that is equal to 0.27, like that. Now, excuse the fact that I made an error when I was speaking about converting hours to seconds. Excuse that, please. So yeah, that was reasonably straightforward. Like I said, look at video number 10 or question 10 if that doesn't make perfect sense to you. Next. The speed of a car is reduced from 72 kilometers an hour to 50 kilometers an hour over a distance of 35 meters. So we knew that 72 kilometers. Did we do that in question 10? In actual fact, we did. So 72 kilometers corresponds to. What did I write it down as? Let me look. 20 meters per second. That's 20 meters per second. And 54. Let's convert 54 meters per second. 54 kilometers per hour is equal to 54 times 1,000 meters per hour. So that's 54,000 meters per hour, which is equal to 54,000 divided by 3,600 meters per second, because there are 3,600 seconds in an hour. Okay, so let's just have a look at that. 54,000 divided by 3,600 gives a speed of 15 meters per second. So we have 15 meters per second with 20 meters per second. So let's draw our diagram as normal. We start with a velocity time or speed time graph. Speed is measured in meters per second and time is measured in seconds. We knew that we began at 20 and we finished at 15. We know that it traveled a distance of 35 meters. So we'll say after at time t is equal to t, we're down to 15 meters per second. At time t is equal to 0, we're at 20 meters per second. So we can draw a straight line because the acceleration or the deceleration was uniform. Once again, just finish off our extra squares, like our triangles, like that. We know the total distance is 35 meters. So the area of this underneath this curve is 35 meters. So let's use that to get the time. So it's the area of the triangle plus the area of the rectangle is equal to the distance. Is equal to 35. This is something we've used quite a good bit. So the base of the triangle is t. It's between here and here is just t. It's unknown. So half the base, so that's t over 2 times the perpendicular height, is between 15 and 20. So that's a perpendicular height of 5 meters. Or we'll say 5 units, to 9 meters. Plus the base t times 15 for the rectangle equals 35. So let's pull out our calculator. We'll say first of all 5t is equal to 5t plus 30t is equal to 70 by multiplying across by number 2. Then we have 35t is equal to 70, t is equal to 2 seconds. We don't need our calculator after all. So t is equal to 2 seconds. That's the first thing. That's something we've done quite a good bit. So let's just put down our u of s first. Now this is 2, initial velocity, final velocity. Now, we know that the initial velocity is greater than the final velocity, therefore it is a deceleration. Is that how you spell deceleration? You know something, I'm actually not too sure, but it doesn't really matter. So, we don't know what the deceleration is, so I'm just going to call it A. Do not call it negative A, just call it A. And we do know what the distance is. It is 35 meters. So what formula do we use? Well, try them and see if they work. So V equals U plus AT. We know both V and U. We don't know A, but we know T. Therefore, A is the only unknown, which means we can use it just fine. So try 15 is equal to 20 plus 2A. Minus 5 is equal to 2A. A is equal to minus 5 over 2. A is equal to minus 2.5 meters per second squared. So let's check that in the back of the book. 2.5 meters per second squared is correct. Okay, that's correct. So just note that up here. And find the retardation. Now the retardation, by the way, means deceleration or the slowing down of something. Assuming it's uniform throughout, which we've done. And then it says, if the retardation continues, how much farther will the car travel before coming to rest? So you can see that we've done this question already a number of times. So, remember, if the vehicle is going to slow down to rest, it's going to continue with the same deceleration to a time t1. The initial velocity for this segment is equal to the final velocity of this segment, which is equal to 15 meters per second. The final velocity is equal to zero. The deceleration, as we just found, is equal to 2.5. Find the rest. As we've done before, V is equal to U plus A times T. 0 is equal to 15 minus 2.5 T. So 15 over 2.5 is equal to T, because the negative signs will cancel. So 15 divided by 2.5 is equal to 6 seconds. That's the first thing. I know I did that reasonably quickly. You can pause the video if that's going too quickly. So the distance. What formula do I usually use? I try S equal to U plus V over 2 times the time. The only unknown in that case is the distance, therefore we're able to do it. So we're going to go for S is equal to U, 15, plus V, 0, over 2 times 6. So that's 7.5. times 6, S is equal to like 45 or something, is it? Yeah, 45. Like that. Check that in the back of the book as normal, and we see that is correct. So 45 meters is correct. And that was section 2A, or exercise 2A of chapter 2. I would like to think that was reasonably straightforward. Once you understood the UVAST formulae, well, to be quite honest, nothing else changed. Everything else was the exact same. So anyway, thanks for watching. Please pass the video on to your friends and subscribe to my channel.